in just 1 minute here. We had a couple technical things we had to sort out, and we're going to launch here in about 20 seconds or so and get started. Let us know right now in your chat where you're watching from today. We'd love to give shout outs here on the program. And also, any questions that you have for Marty throughout the show, make sure you add those to the chat, and we'll make sure to get those asked live here on the show to our guest author. He's going to start off doing a presentation for us, and then we'll go into our Q&A and discussion and book giveaway. All right, so welcome to the show, everyone. We're going to get started in just a few seconds. Again, if you're joining in our Zoom webinar, go ahead and let us know in your chat right now. We'd love to know where you're watching from, and we'll get started here in just a couple seconds. All right. Welcome back, everyone. We're going to go ahead and get started with our live guest speaker today on the program. Hello, my name is Brandon. I'm going to be your host on today's Read Around the World program. So if you're not familiar, Read Around the World is a show where we invite authors and illustrators and other creators on the show to share their stories and their travel and lived experiences from different locations around the world. We love to travel through books here at Learn Around the World just as much as we do virtual field trips. With that said, we're going to go ahead and get started with today's program that starts right now. All right, all right, all right. Welcome back to the program, everyone. You are now watching Learn Around the World's Read Around the World. And before we get started, we'd like to acknowledge before we start every program that we are coming to you live today from our studio located in Portland, Maine. And before we begin all of our programs, we'd like to go ahead and acknowledge we're coming to you live today from ancestral land of the Wabanaki Confederacy. This includes peoples that have been living in from Vermont all the way through in the USA through Nova Scotia, Canada for the past 10,000 years and still live on these lands today. And in English, Wabanaki roughly translates to people of the Dawn Land because the sun rises every morning over the Atlantic Ocean and hits the Dawn Land first. But today, I want you to think about your home explorers, where you're watching from. Another reminder, let us know where you're watching from right now. We would love to give you a shout out right here live on the program to your classrooms and schools around the globe. And we'd like to go ahead and introduce our guest author today, which is an award-winning author that, especially with his mystery series, I'll let him explain to you today more about his works. He's going to do a short select reading for us and short presentation of one of his books, and then we'll open it up for Q&A and discussion with our guest author. And our guest author today is coming to you live from Edmonton, Canada, and that's where we will be connecting with live here on the program to our guest author today, which is no other than Marty Chan. As we bring Marty on today, Marty's going to go ahead and introduce a bit to us about Edmonton, where he's joining to us live. We can see Edmonton is located on a river. I've never been there personally, so I can't wait to learn more about this from Marty. Welcome to the show, Marty.
Thanks for having me, Brandon. And good morning or good afternoon to all of you, depending on what time zone you're in. I am broadcasting all the way from Edmonton, Canada, or Edmonton, Alberta, which is a wonderful province in Canada. It's in sort of Western Canada, and it's kind of like almost it's landlocked in the sense that there are no oceans around us. So we are our main source being water, which is why in Edmonton, we've got this beautiful North Saskatchewan River that runs through the city. And we have beautiful walks that people can go on in the river valley. And what you're looking at right over here are two bridges. One is for the light rail transit system, the sort of subway system in our city. And the other, the taller bridge, is basically the high level bridge where we have car traffic. It used to be a train bridge, and there's still a streetcar that operates that runs from the south side of the city across the river to the north side of the city. But that's more of a tourist attraction than something that people use to commute back and forth across the city. Most people drive through the city, and here's a wider view of the city. We often talk about living in Alberta having a big sky, because we are on the prairies, and you see a lot of sky overhead, and that gives us a sense of the kind of city that I'm in. Now, I don't get to see much of the city because I have been in my basement of my house doing virtual presentations for the last 2 years, because apparently something's been going on for the last 2 years, which is causing us all to be indoors for a while. And so what I have done is I've actually turned my office into a virtual studio. And I'm going to give you a quick tour of my studio right now. If you follow me over here, this is where I do all my writing. So I've got my computer set up. I've got my keyboard right here where I type up all my stories. And if you notice over my shoulder, there's a Batman. Let me turn on the light. You can see him better. So over here, Batman actually serves a purpose. He's actually sitting on a bunch of file holders. And these boxes actually contain all the stories I'm working on currently. I usually work on about 3 to 5 projects at the same time. And to keep myself organized, what I do is I take all the notes, the research, the outlines, and the drafts, and I put them into different boxes so I can keep my thoughts organized. And the reason my studio, and let me see if I can give you a tour of my space. So follow me, if you will. So over here, I've got a ring light that gives me enough light on my face so people can see me. Back here, I've got some LED lights with colored bulbs that shine like a really cool light on my backdrop, which is actually hiding something not so pretty. I'll tell you what it is in a second. But over here on this side of my studio is my bookcase, where I have some of the things I'm really proud of. I've got an award that I won for a play I wrote. And down here, these are some of the books I'm really proud of. Now, I said that this backdrop was actually hiding something not so pretty. I'm actually working in my basement, and my basement was actually decorated by the previous owner in the 1970s. Your teachers might recognize this kind of basement, but behind the backdrop, there is a wagon wheel light that hangs from the ceiling. There is missing ceiling tiles. There's a lot of fake wood paneling walls. And if you look down at the floor, that red, that's not a camera problem. That's actually the original carpet from the previous owner. Now, I didn't think that, you know, an ugly basement from the 1970s would make a good backdrop. So instead, what I did was I added in the backdrop with the colored lights. And I'm hoping you like this a little better than my basement. Now, in addition to doing virtual presentations, I've also been making YouTube videos. And right over here in another part of my basement, this is where I actually shoot my videos. I've got a camera set up with some lights and a green screen so people can actually see what's going on. And I also do reading performances. And right over here in front of my bookcase, this is where I do my reading performances. So that's a really quick tour of my space. Now let's talk about some of the books that I've written. To do that, I probably should show you, okay? So we're gonna go to my digital collection on my website, okay? So, yeah, okay, let's see, what can I show you? What can I show you? Maybe, that'd be interesting. Let's see. Oh, no, wait, I think I see it. Yeah, this one right over here, okay? All right, so let's get rid of this. And we're going to talk about this book right over here. So this is my book, The Mystery of the Frozen Brains, which is actually the very first book I wrote. And it's also a good example of how I like to work as a writer. You see, I like to take real life stuff from my own life, and use it as the starting point for my books. So The Mystery of the Frozen Brains was actually inspired by something that happened to me when I was young. When I was a kid, my parents, they actually moved to a small town in Alberta, in Canada, and the town's about 15 miles north of the city, and they bought a grocery store there. And when we showed up, our family was the very first Chinese people who showed up in the town. When I went to school, I didn't look like the other kids in my class, and in the beginning, nobody wanted to talk to me, nobody wanted to be my friend, I was sad and lonely, I kind of wished the kids would stop picking on me. Well, if you're being picked on at school, the best place to hide is the library, because the bookcases are so tall, you can squeeze between the bookcases and disappear from everybody. And what I would do is I'd grab a book from the shelf, crack it open, and I'd hide behind the cover. One of the books I hid behind was this book right over here, The Hardy Boys, The Tower Treasure. If you don't know the Hardy Boys, they're two brothers. Their names are Frank and Joe Hardy, and they live in a small town called Bayport, and they solve mysteries, right? They try to catch criminals. And there's over 50 books in this series, and I loved reading these books. In fact, I loved reading the books so much, I wanted to be just like the two Hardy Boys, just like Frank and Joe Hardy. Well, if I'm going to be honest, I actually went to be Frank. Hey, wait a minute. What's wrong with being Joe? Anyway, I wanted to be just like, well, one of the Hardy Boys. Now, I had the perfect training ground to be a detective. It was my parents' grocery store. At the store, I turned myself into the store detective. I would be on the lookout for any shoplifters, anybody trying to steal from my parents. And I took my job very seriously. I made myself a little cardboard badge. Pinned it on the inside of my jacket. Anytime a customer walked in, I would just flash them my badge. I'd be like, Marty Chan, store detective. I've got my eye on you. Now, in case I caught a shoplifter, I had a pair of plastic handcuffs that I clipped to the back of my belt. And I would patrol the aisles telling all the customers that I was in charge. I was the store detective. But the weird thing was, none of the grown-ups would take me seriously, right? I'd walk up to a customer and I'd be like, Mrs. Johnson, I've got my eye on you. I know you're trying to steal my dad's grapes. And then she just patted me on the head and said, oh, you're a strange boy. I was like, hey, take me seriously. I'm a real detective. And then I started thinking, hey, maybe I'm missing something. So I started watching TV shows about cops and detectives. And very quickly, I learned that they had something that I did not. They had guns. And I thought I needed to get my own gun. So I got my hands on a water pistol called the Super Squirter. I filled it up with water. I jammed it down the front of my pants. Now, unfortunately, the Super Squirter was super leaky. So I didn't look like the store detective. I just looked like the boy who couldn't get to the bathroom in time. Now, it wasn't enough to be a store detective. And I'm hoping that there's a school on camera or there are schools active on chat, because we're going to try a little guessing game. I wanted to be some other characters from different books, and I'm going to describe the characters from the books that I wanted to be like, and I want to see if you can guess what the characters were, okay? So the first character that I wanted to be like actually was a comic book superhero, and let's see if you can guess who this hero is. He was one of the Avengers. And he ran around with a round metal shield that he threw at the villains. Does anybody know who that hero is? Oh, I see a few hands. Oh, shout it out. Shout it out. The school in Mexico. Go ahead, Wexford. Go ahead and shout out the name of that. Oh, I don't hear that. Maybe the mic's off. Oh, they're consulting. They're consulting. Anyone? Anyone?
Your microphone should be unmuted over in Mexico. I will go ahead and say while they are consulting, we have some answers coming in over chat. And so looks like we have, I see some big wavings going. So we'll see if they can, we'll give them another second to see if they can unmute in Mexico. And because we had it working earlier, and if they can't in the next couple of seconds, then we'll take our chat answers.
Oh, got somebody running up. Somebody's running up to the computer. Nope, somebody's coming past the computer.
No worries. So we'll come back to them in just 1 minute, Marty. And as we're waiting on them, we do have some answers coming in and some shout-outs to give out as well. So we have Bartlett, second graders from Bartlett, Illinois, joining us today as well. And I believe Mrs. Roberts' classroom is joining us from, I believe they are in Arkansas, if memory serves me correctly. So shout-out Arkansas as well. And so our classroom and our second graders are saying Captain America. Is Captain America the answer there, Marty?
Captain America is correct. I'm going to give you infinity thumbs up for that. Captain America is indeed the character I wanted to be like. Now, the only way that I could become Captain America was to, to have a shield made out of vibranium. The only problem was I didn't have any vibranium. However, my dad had a lot of cardboard boxes in the store. So I grabbed a pair of scissors and I grabbed a cardboard box and I cut out a giant shield that was mostly round or circular. And I had pencil crayons to color in my designs and kite strings for my handles. There was another superhero I also wanted to be like. And let's see if we can guess from this, either chat or Wexford, if your mic is working. I'm going to give you the other names this character was known by. You tell me what his superhero name was. He was sometimes known as the Cape Crusader. Or Bruce Wayne, or the Dark Knight. Anybody know who that superhero is?
Do you hear us?
Yes, we do.
I hear you.
So anyone would like to answer? Batman.
Batman, excellent. Thumbs up for that. You are correct. So, yes, give yourselves a round of applause. Batman was awesome. And the reason why he was so awesome is because he had this utility belt with all these cool gadgets on them. And I actually wanted my own Batman utility belt. So I actually borrowed my dad's leather belt. I wrapped it around my body twice. And I needed to have gadgets, but I also needed things to hold the gadgets in. And I'm not sure if anybody's come across these candies, but Tic Tacs were these awesome, sweet, crunchy candies that came in these little plastic boxes. Now, the plastic boxes were the perfect size to hold gadgets for a kid. And what I would do is I'd actually empty the Tic Tac boxes and fill them up with my own gadgets, right? In one Tic Tac box, I had a bunch of safety pins. In another Tic Tac box, I had some dental floss. That was my bat rope. I would pull it out, I'd tie it around a banana, and that became my batarang. And I'd run around the store with all these cool things. But Wasn't enough to just be a comic book Hardy Boy superhero detective. There was an old movie that I saw, and I wanted to be one of the characters in this old movie. Now, it's pretty ancient, so I'm not sure if anybody will recognize this movie, but Mexico or Wexford School, see if anybody recognizes this movie right over here. And in chat, if you know, you can type in as well. Anyone got a guess what this movie is?
All right. Do we have a guess? Do we guess have a guess over in Wexford?
Star Wars. Awesome. Okay, stay on camera for a second. My favorite character in Star Wars was the Jedi Knight because he had this awesome weapon. Wexford, show me what it looks like when you're using a Jedi Knight's weapon. Do me a favor, show me what it looks like when you're using a Jedi Knight's weapon. What does that look like? Does anybody know how to use it? Oh, wait, there we go. I see somebody playing baseball. Somebody swinging a bat. Somebody smelling their armpit. Oh, no, there we go. That's a lightsaber. Yes, it's a lightsaber. Oh, we've got a team coming up. Show us your lightsaber moves. It looks like they're chopping a tree down. That's awesome. That's great. All right. For that acting, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to give you a dancing Darth Vader for that effort. Great job. We can dance if we want to. We can leave your friends behind. Because your friends don't dance. And if they don't dance, well, they're no friends of mine. All right. So I wanted to have my own lightsaber. Today, you could go to the store and buy your own lightsaber. When I was a kid, they were not selling lightsabers in the store, so you had to make your own up. So I took a wrapping paper tubes, those long tubes that wrapping paper is wrapped around. I would fill them up with my rolled up comic book and put masking tape on either end. And I'd run around with my lightsaber, my Batman utility belt, my Captain America shield, and my super squirter water pistol. And I would pretend that bad guys were coming into my dad's store to steal things. Well, one day I pretended that Darth Vader himself had come into my dad's store to steal salad dressing. And it was my job to stop Darth Vader from taking all the salad dressing. So I tried to capture him. First thing I did was I pulled out my banana batarang. I tried to hook his legs, except the banana went flying into somebody's shopping cart. Then I took out my Captain America shield and I tried to throw it at him, but the shield went flying up into the ceiling and got stuck in the tiles. Then I remembered I had my super squirter water pistol. I pulled it out, but all the water had drained out into my pants. Oops. The only thing I was left with was the lightsaber. So I got into an imaginary battle with Darth Vader, and I got a little too excited. I remember I swung around and I swung the right lightsaber down as hard as I could. The force of the swing caused the rolled up comic books inside the cardboard tube to shoot out, and they became missiles aimed at a tower of glass salad dressing bottles. And I watched in terror as the bottles fall over and break all over the floor. After that, I had to retire as a superhero detective and take on my new job as the store janitor. Now, by making a mess, that's how I met my first best friend. You see, my first best friend, his name was Jay, and his family actually lived in the house right behind my parents' grocery store. And the thing you need to know about Jay's family is they had this beautiful dog, a German Shepherd, that loved Jay and his family, but the dog did not like strangers. So anytime somebody walked past the backyard, the German Shepherd would bark and chase after them. Now, I didn't know this because I'd never been outside the back of my dad's store until I made that mess. And I remember I walked out the back doors and I heard this monster woof. I look up and I see Jay's German Shepherd running across the yard toward me. It hops over the short fence between the yard and the alley, and it gets about this far from my face when the chain that's holding it to the stake in the backyard snaps tight. And now I have this huge German Shepherd pawing the air in front of me. It's barking, it's snarling. I think I see foam coming out of its mouth. I'm so scared, I drop my bag of garbage and I run back into my dad's store and I start crying to my dad. I'm like, Dad, I can't take out the garbage. There's a monster outside. Well, he took care of it. He went over and introduced himself to Jay's family. next thing you know, Jay came over and introduced himself to me, and he convinced me to go over and play with the dog. And because I was with Jay, the dog started to like me. And after that, Jay and I would get together almost every day to play road hockey. That's something that we often do in Alberta, was we play hockey, but in the street. So basically, kind of looks like this, right? Now, Jay was an awesome hockey player, and the way he got to be so great is he practiced every single day. His idea of playing road hockey was basically to make me stand in net while he fired slap shots at me. Now, the only problem is I didn't have any goalie equipment, so we needed to make up my protection. And I had my comics in my socks to protect my legs. My hockey glove was an old oven mitt, and my goalie stick was my mom's feather duster. Now, one day it got so hot outside, we couldn't play hockey any longer, and we needed to cool off. And I thought my parents might have some ice cream in the refrigerator. So Jay and I, we go into my parents' house, tiptoe across the kitchen. We get to the refrigerator. I crack open the freezer door. I look inside for some popsicles or freezies or something cold to eat. I can't find any ice cream, but Jay, he notices this weird plastic bag that's covered in ice in the corner of the freezer. He points out and goes, "Hey, Marty, what's that?" I go, "I don't know." So I reach in, I pull out this plastic bag. I'm holding it like this. Jay leans over. We're both trying to figure out what this thing is. Well, I start to scrape the ice off from the bag. And as soon as I clear the last bit of ice from the bag, we both realize that what I'm holding in the palm of my hand is a bag of frozen brains. I turn to Jay and he's gone. He's out of the house in 2 seconds flat. I'm left holding this bag of frozen brains going, "Oh, what is it?" I panic. I throw it back in the freezer. I slam the door shut. I run and hide in the corner and I wait till my mom comes home from work. As soon as she comes to the door, I tackle her. I grab her by the sleeve. I'm like, mom, there's a gross thing in the freezer. What is it? What is it?" My mom shakes me off and goes, "Relax. Don't worry about it. It's just frozen cow brains." I was like, "Ew, frozen cow brains. Mom, what are we going to do with frozen cow brains?" You know that feeling you have when you ask a question? As soon as you hear the answer, you kind of wish you never asked the question in the first place. Well, that's how I felt, because my mom's answer was, "Well, silly, tonight we're going to eat cow brain stew." I know, I was so scared of eating cow brain stew that when dinner time came, I actually hid in my bedroom and I refused to come out. And while I was hiding in my bedroom, I kept thinking, why on earth would my parents want to eat cow brain stew? And I started thinking, hey, maybe it's because my parents are not of this earth. And I started thinking my parents were aliens from outer space and they were trying to take over human brains one at a time. That was the inspiration for the mystery of the frozen brains. Now, if you're wondering, are my parents aliens? No, they're kind of goofy. They're kind of strange. But as far as I know, they're human beings. But they did become the characters in my book.
So sorry to disappoint, but I am not an alien. My parents are not aliens. There are no such thing as aliens coming to the planet Earth and living among you, secretly taking notes and possibly planning an invasion. What? What? I pressed the wrong button. Look away. Look away. Look away.
Okay, hopefully I look human again. Anyway, that is the real life story behind the mystery of the frozen brains. And hopefully it'll inspire some of you to want to grab that book and give it a read. And right now, Brandon, I think I've got a couple of minutes for any questions that people have. So I'm going to turn it over to you now.
All right. So thank you so much. That was amazing to hear the story behind Marty's amazing book, The Mystery of the Frozen Brains. And if anyone, by the way, is curious where to find Marty's book. Awesome. So I just recognized that my mic was off. There we go. So if anyone would like to know where they could find Marty's book, The Mystery of the Frozen Brains and any of his other mystery series and other books as well, just head on over to MartyChan.com and you can find those as well. We do have a couple of minutes, as Marty just told us. He has gracious enough to lend us his time today. And we have lots of folks out there. So again, just a reminder, you can use your Zoom chat to let us know any of the questions that you may have. If you are watching on Twitter, you like to roam your classroom teachers, you can either at me at LearnATW for at Learn Around the World, or use the hashtag Read Around the World. We'll see it at either of those places as well if you prefer using Twitter to send in your questions. And of course, we have our own camera guest classroom as well. So we're going to start there. So we're going to go over to our own camera classroom. Do we have any questions from your classroom that you would like to ask Mr. Chan?
You guys have questions?
All right, so as we're waiting for them to walk up to the camera or to relay from the teacher, again, reminder out there to send your or type your questions into the chat. And so we have one coming in right now, Marty, from our second graders in Illinois, and they want to know, what is your favorite book that you have ever wrote?
Oh, okay. My favorite book of all the ones I've written, it's actually a personal favorite because it's connected to my two favorite things in the world. It's a picture book called True Story that was inspired by these two guys right here. These are, well, they were my two favorite cats in the world. Their names were Buddy and Max. Sadly, both of them have passed away, but they now live forever in my personal favorite book, True Story, in which one cat is blamed for all the trouble that a little boy causes. And in real life, my cats were constantly causing trouble. Max was stealing my pens, and Buddy was a scaredy cat. And they were two cats I loved very much, and they became the inspiration for my personal favorite book, True Story.
Awesome. Great there. We're going to go back over to Wexford School, and let's see if they have someone ready to ask their question. You are unmuted now.
Okay, can you turn off your mask and ask a question very loud, very loud?
What was your inspiration?
Again, speak louder.
Come closer to the camera too.
What was your inspiration?
I'll get. Sorry,
your inspiration. What's your inspiration to write your books? I think he's asking.
There we go. All right. Thank you for that question. I'll give you a thumbs up for sticking with me on that one. The inspiration for me to become, to write that book was basically wanting to show people that so there are people out there who come from different countries. They may not look like the people in the community, but I wanted them to know that we're just the same as everybody else. We have the same fears, the same hopes, and that's what I wanted to accomplish with the Mystery of the Frozen Brains. So if you're talking about the inspiration to become a writer, that actually came from an old teacher of mine. I'm gonna give a shout out to teachers for inspiring kids to become anything that we can. My old language arts teacher gave our class a homework assignment, and it was a writing assignment to describe our dream bedroom. When I handed it in, my teacher said, Marty, you've got a great imagination. You should become a writer. And because of what he said to me, I said, you know what? I should become a writer. And I went to university to learn how to write. And I have been writing for, I'm pretty old. I've been writing for 40 years ever since that moment. So because of one teacher inspiring me, I became the writer that I am today. All right. Thank you for that question.
All right, we have another great question coming in from chat from Gonzalez's classroom. What is your next project going to be about? Do you have any ideas for your next book that you can share?
Right now, that's a great question. Right now, I'm playing around with the idea of a girl detective who discovers that somebody in the school has flooded the girls' bathroom toilets, and it's up to her to try to catch the culprit. And right now the working title for that is detention. All right, so thank you for that question. You know what, I like that question so much, I'm going to give you a cat shack shimmy for that. All right, that's enough cat shack shimmy. Okay, all right.
Hey,
are there any other questions?
I don't think you can ever have too many shimmies. So let's see. Do you use the same illustrator for all of your books?
Oh, wow, that's a really good question. I use different illustrators. Well, it's not my choice. The publisher is the one who chooses the illustrators. So for my picture book, that was illustrated by Lorna Bennett, another artist from Edmonton, Alberta. So she's a local, well, local for me. The Mystery of the Frozen Brains was actually illustrated by somebody out of Nova Scotia. Let's see, what was the another one? And over here, Barnabas Bigfoot is a series that I wrote, and that was illustrated by a Calgary artist, also from Alberta, named Derek Ma. So different illustrators for different books, and it really is up to the publisher to choose who does the illustrations. They get to read the book, so they kind of know what to aim for. And the reality is, as a writer, I don't actually see the cover of the book until just before the book is printed. So I don't actually have a say in what the cover is going to look like, which, you know, is one of those tough things about being an author. You have to wait and see. It's kind of like waiting for a birthday or a Christmas present. You don't know what it's going to be. And when you open it up, you hope that you're going to be happy with what you get. And most of the time you are. The rare time you're not. But for the most part, I'm pretty happy with the covers I have.
All right. So keep those questions coming in. Before I know, Marty's going to have to head out here in the next minute or so. And before we do all start to say goodbye, we want to go ahead and give away a copy of The Mystery of the Frozen Brains for all of our live participating classrooms. And I'm sorry, everyone from a lot of classrooms have joined us from Mexico to see their star student body on camera with us today. So maybe if you can share, it's possibly if one of you wins. But let's go ahead and find out who's that winner is going to be today. All right, so Alejandro Paredes, is classroom. You're going to get a copy of The Mystery of the Frozen Brain. So congratulations to your classroom. Woo! Maybe you can share it with the rest of your school as well. And all right, so let me just check in. Marty, how are you doing on time? Do you have time to take any more questions?
Yeah, I've got about 5 more minutes.
All right, so go ahead and let's go back to our star guest of the day in Mexico, and we'll turn on their audio, and it looks like we have someone ready to ask a question.
Okay, you can take off your mask and get closer to the camera.
So it's tough to hear. So either can you repeat and speak louder, or if our teacher can relay the question closer to the microphone.
If you, I think that you have in all your life, all things that fit with you, are you separate? And are you separate all the things that you have?
Sorry, Brandon, were you able to pick that up? Because my mic or my speaker's not picking it up.
I can't make it out either.
Sorry.
Okay. Let me try to. Can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay. Shannon is asking, if you have received any criticism in your life, how did you deal with that?
Sorry,
I'm getting a lot of echoing in the classroom. If you can, maybe and see if you can type the question. Yeah, if you can type the question, then we will definitely get it asked for you. So sorry about that, and we'll get that question in. We have a Mr. B's classroom wants to know. Alan B's classroom wants to know, how many books have you written in total?
Ooh, I can show you how many books I've written in total. Right over here are my books. So I have 18 books that are published, And I actually have another three on the way. I forgot about that third one. So I've got, in fact, to finish out, maybe I'll show you the cover of one of my new books that's on the way. But they're in process, right? They're going through the editing process. That's part of the job of being a writer, is you don't just write the story and it gets printed and it becomes a book. You have to go through the editing process where you have to revise and make changes to make the story clearer, more exciting, make the characters a little more dynamic. And then, of course, you have to fix spelling mistakes, which I often make spelling mistakes when I write because I'm typing so fast. Sometimes should I admit it? Okay. I do tend to type words twice. That's my fatal flaw as a writer, is because I'm writing so fast that sometimes I type the same word twice. So I have to go through and edit. And I actually work with an editor who's kind of like your teacher, goes over your work and tells you what's working, tells you what needs fixing, and sort of guides you through that process. And those three books that I'm working on right now, going through that process of editing where I have to make the changes to make it better. All right, good question. I'm going to give you, what shall I give you for that one? I'm going to give you a Kylo Ren thumbs up for that one.
All right. So thank you so much for sharing that as well, because I think that's a common theme we've learned from all of our authors here, is that unlike some of us might think, like myself growing up, authors make mistakes too, and we all need to edit. So no matter how you feel your writing ability is and where it's at, everyone edits and everyone corrects those mistakes. So I think it's a valuable lesson to hear over and over and over again. So I have the typed question, so I'm going to go ahead and ask that because it's a fantastic one. And our second graders have to head out in Illinois. They said, thank you very much, Mr. Chan, and they learned so much and are very appreciative of your time. And so back to what's for school, they want to know, or they were asking, you were talking about growing up and your inspiration as a writer when you were young. And so the question is, if you were criticized, and it sounds like you were at times as a younger person, how did you manage, or what are maybe some things that got you through that time period?
That's a fantastic question. One of the toughest things about being the only Chinese kid in a school was I was often picked on and teased and criticized and made fun of. And I'll be honest with you, I was very lonely and really sad at the beginning. But I realized that I had to find a way to win over the other kids. And if you've probably guessed by my presentation, I use a lot of comedy. I use humor to try to win people over. And what I found was, if I started telling jokes, if I started making fun of things, not other people, but making fun of other things, people started laughing, not at me, but they started laughing at my jokes. And that allowed me to sort of break down the sort of prejudices that people had about me, and they started to get to know me as a person. So all through my life, I've used humor as a way to sort of get people to calm down a little bit and go, oh, I know you look different, but you seem kind of funny, and so I'm going to listen to you more. So that was how I learned to cope with it, but it still hurts. Like, even to this day, I still remember pretty much every bully that said something nasty to me, everyone that pushed me. I still remember it to this day, and I hold it in my heart as a way that I want to make sure that nobody else is treated the same way. And so what I try to do is I try my best to help other people when they're being picked on. And so I'm hoping that the books I write kind of show that those people who are like me, who are being picked on, that they know they're not alone. And I think one of the most powerful things that you can do for anybody is to let them know that they're not alone. So if you ever see someone who's a victim of bullies, the best thing to do is just go up and talk to them and get to know them. Because once they realize they're not alone, they feel a lot more confident about themselves, all right? So that's a great question. I'm going to give you a standing ovation for that question. That was awesome.
All right, and shout out, who likes telling jokes? Who likes to use humor out there? So I see lots of hands out there for telling jokes. we have another fantastic question coming in, and we'll make this our Ooh, a lot of them are coming in now. So let's get here. We'll say two, and we'll let you head out, Marty. I know you're very busy today. How long does it typically take you to write a book? I know it may be different from book to book, but is there a sweet spot that you've found?
Oh, yeah. Usually when I write, it takes me, I would say, anywhere from 6 weeks to 2 months to write what I call my first draft. And I call it my first draft because I actually revise it quite a bit before I actually show somebody what it looks like. So I'll probably go through it maybe two or three times before I have something that I'm happy with. And that'll take me as long as 2 months for a shorter book. And it can take me up to 6 months if it's a longer work. So a book that's like 15,000 words, 2 months. If it's 50,000 words, it'll take me up to 6 months. And before I actually show it to the publisher, I'll show it to my wife, who gives me feedback, and I'll make revisions from that. And that revision process can span over another 2 to 3 months, because what I'll do is I'll revise it for different things. I'll go through and I'll look at the characters. I'll look at it for the story. I'll look at it for dialogue. I'll look at it for spelling. I'll look at it for flow. So I'll look at it a number of different ways and different times until I have something that's pretty solid before I send it off to publisher. And it has paid off. Like the last three or four books that I have sent off to publishers, the editor said, we're just going to make some minor corrections. The story is pretty solid. The characters are there. So it's been one of those things that's very, very informative, that if you put all the work in ahead of time, it makes it less work for the editor down the line. So I always say, put your best foot forward. Don't just hand in the first thing that you do. All right. Great question. I'm going to give you a round of puppy applause for that one.
All right. We love those puppy applauses. And so we did want to give a shout out. We had from Mr. Cruz's classroom saying greetings from Six Blue Campus. So for those watching from Mexico as well. And so I think this is a double question from earlier, but I'll just rephrase it so it's a little bit new for us, and we'll make this our final question before we say goodbye. And so it's about getting your inspiration for your books, and let's just shift that to you told us about your newest idea, your newest book coming up, and is there a particular inspiration for that book?
Oh yeah, for the book Detention, the pandemic has gone on for 2 years. So during that 2 years, I had a lot of time on my hands. So I started listening to podcasts, and I got interested in a whole bunch of different podcasts about like crime investigations. And there was a one called Serial, which was done by a journalist named Sarah Koenig. And it was about trying to, you know, track down whether a person who was charged with a crime, if he was actually guilty or innocent. And she went on this journey to sort of sift through all the evidence to find out for herself if this guy was truly innocent or guilty. And I thought I wanted to do the same kind of thing, but more on a kid level. So the idea was the girl detective was a podcaster, and she was investigating crimes at her school and making a podcast about it. Of course, by making a podcast, she got in trouble because a lot of people heard it, and I don't know, you know, gossip in schools. So some of the podcasts she put out had a little bit of gossip, which got her in a lot of trouble. So that was the inspiration behind Detention. I'm going to give you tens across the board for all those amazing questions. Thank you so much for asking those questions. And now, Brandon, if you don't mind, I would like to show everybody the cover of one of the books that I'm working on, or that's going to be coming out. So if everybody is into it, give me a thumbs up or type in yes if you want to see the cover of one of my new books.
I see a lot of thumbs up out there.
Thumbs up. All right. Excellent. Okay. Eyes on the screen. Here is the cover of my new book. It's called Willpower. All right. Eyes on the screen. Here is my book, Willpower. Never gonna give you. Sorry.
Did you just Rickroll us?
I can't. I know, 2022, you're like, I'm done with Rickrolling. Okay, all right. I got it on my system. Okay, here for real is my book, Willpower. Twice, I got you twice. Okay, now for sure. Now for sure it's out of my system. It's out of, don't leave. Okay, all right. Here for real is my book, Willpower. So willpower is all about a girl who has the ability to move objects with her mind, and she's being pursued by a scientist who wants to use her for lab experiments. It's a really cool action adventure story with a little bit of supernatural in it, and I'm hoping you get a chance to check out Willpower. All right. I hope you enjoyed the presentation. I hope you get a chance to check out my books at martychan.com. And and also check out my YouTube channel where I have writing tips to help students become better writers. So if you're interested in that, you can check out my YouTube channel, which is at Marty Chan Author. All right. Take care, everybody. I hope you have a great day, and I will see you all later.
All right. Thank you so much, Marty. And let's go over and say goodbye to our classroom over in Wexford Schools as well. Bye, bye everyone. Awesome. They said thank you so much for this excellent experience. Go out there, everyone. Check out MartyChan.com for all of Marty's books. And if you can't wait to see a new author from a different part of the world, and join us back next week where we'll be hosting Miss Zanette Kamal with her second book. We had her on last fall with Proud in Her Hijab, when she's going to be talking all about cybersecurity and, oh no, hacked again, when she was inspired by her kids that got hacked. And so we'll be learning all about her new amazing book and learning about those inspirations for that as well. Until next time, bye everyone, and keep reading around the world.